talk here, our lecture series. So this will be our final lecture of the semester, and we'll start back up in the fall. And we're very fortunate to have Ryan come and talk to us about healthcare from Google. Ryan's been at Google for about 10 years, and look forward to some good questions. And Ryan, take it away.
All right. Thank you for coming. Hey, everyone. So Julie, you look, you fit right in.
Thank you.
Like you're one of the students.
You
also look like you're 20, 21 as well. But Julie and I went to high school together in Bolton, Massachusetts. So I've been in New York now for over 20 years, but any chance I get to come up to this area, I jump at it. So when Julie asked if I'd come speak to you, I said I would gladly do it. So today I want to talk about Google. And when you think of Google, everyone here uses Google, right?
Yep.
Everyone has Gmail. Anyone here have like AOL email address? I'm gonna make fun of you if you do. My friend in the back. Oh, nice. Hotmail? Anyone?
I still have an old AOL.
Come on, my man. Well, you know what? It's because he's. How old are you? He's over 20.
I'm older than 21.
<He's> like, anyone? What's that?
I said I also have a Gmail address.
Nice. I'm trying to convert the world to Google, you know, one at a time. But at Google, you know, we do a lot more than just search. So I wanted to actually share, even though I run healthcare at Google, and you're probably all wondering what the heck does that mean, I'm going to share some of the things that we're doing within health. But our world has become much bigger than search. And in fact, I've been at Google over 10 years. And by the way, I just celebrated my 10-year anniversary. You know what you get for that? You think it'd be like a fancy watch or a car. You get a plaque. It's like $12 plaque. But everyone is like dying for that plaque. You know, it's a badge of honor. It's in my office front and center. To make it 10 years at Google is a big deal, considering that we're only 18 years old. So, and when you think of Google, and if you've probably studied about Google and similar companies, Google has radically disrupted our world in so many ways. Business, health, in virtually every area that you touch, gaming. Google has had our hand in that one way or another. So I wanted to talk through that, and this goes, and by the way, this goes so far beyond Google, and I'll share some of those details as well. But before I do, I wanted to play a little game, and we have a big prize for the winner. So if you know this answer, I just want you to raise your hand. I don't want you to blurt it out. So does anyone know the answer, the number? Okay, have you seen this before, or are you just a genius?
No, I've seen it before.
Okay, we have one. Wow, damn you. You know what's amazing? You guys are pretty good. Okay, hands keep going. Okay, this is fascinating. So I'm gonna actually give the prize to my friend here.
Thank you.
You got a Google hat. You probably don't wear hats, do you?
No, I do, actually.
Okay, that's a pretty cool hat though, right? So the answer, by the way, I asked this question a couple weeks ago. I presented to 2,000 people. Almost the entire room were doctors or PhDs. Almost nobody gets the question right. You ask this question to a bunch of 12-year-olds, and it's amazing how many will get that question right. And the reason being is that all the education you have, you think of all these PhDs and all these doctorates, and people who have spent their whole life being well-trained, all their experiences has taught them to look at problems in a certain way. So you've been hardwired to look at a problem in a certain way, and if I just said to anyone who hasn't gotten it by now, if you just simply flipped it on its head, it's so painfully simple. But you have all these companies, and look at all these CEOs who are hardwired to look at a problem a certain way. And that's a big, big problem. And why disruption of all these companies? So most of you in this room are too young to remember the Blockbuster craze. But have you all studied about Blockbuster? And remember that Blockbuster, the crazy story about that is not that you have some CEO saying, no, our model is perfect. Of course people are going to drive to the store and they're going to rent a movie and then they're going to pay all these late fees when they're late. And so then Netflix comes around. You know how long Netflix was around before Blockbuster said, you know what, maybe we should change our business model and this online video thing has legs? 5 years. Netflix was there for 5 years before some idiot at Blockbuster said, you know, we really should switch. And there, of course, we're too late. And you think of all these other companies. You know who invented the digital camera? It's Kodak. Kodak, who now, but because they moved too slowly and they were disrupted, and because of that, these companies are dying. So we say that because you look at Google. So when we think Google, we think search, right? So we know that there's billions of people who use Google billions of times every day. You all, I assume, use Google. Anyone here besides my friend in the back use Bing? Only joking.
My dad
Nobody
uses Bing.
Yeah, his dad. His old dad uses Bing.
Ask Jeeves.
Oh, man, I should give you a t-shirt for that. That was good. Okay, so I have some cool, and I'm hoping whoever wins this is an extra large man. But, so how many products does Google have that have over a billion users? What do you think?
A million of them?
No. So how many products, so Google search is one product. I'll give you a hint. YouTube is another product, so that's two. So it's more than two. Anyone?
I would guess around 15.
15? So not 15. So it's less than 10 and it's more than two.
Five?
Five? No.
I was going to say four.
So I'm looking for a extra large man right now to get this right.
Eight.
Close enough. Oh, actually, my buddy here. It is actually a seven. Sorry, my brother. Seven products. So we all use Google. You have YouTube, Chrome, Android. Anyone who has an Android here? Actually, that's pretty cool. You know why? Because when I asked that room of 2,000 people, remember, they all make lots of money, they all live in big cities, and what do they have? They have iPhones, and they think the world has an iPhone, and so everything they're doing is centered around an iPhone and the Mac. When in fact, and I said, by the way, all of you in this room, and this is actually, is anyone, we're being filmed? Okay, I don't want to. So, people who are making these decisions typically are older than me. They have skin color like me, and we call them stale, pale, and male. Okay, I just went there. So, but it's older guys who are making these decisions, and I think they have to see the world differently. Anyway, you have Gmail, you have Maps, you have Google, you have Android. In fact, 85% of our world today is Android. Of all the phones sold, so you talk to anyone in New York City, they would say, what is that number? And they would say, I don't know, 60, 70% iPhone. In fact, only 10% of phones being sold are iPhone, 85% are Android. And I'll talk about Android more in a second because there's lots of good stuff going on there. And then we have our parent company now is Alphabet. So think of Alphabet as like the Berkshire Hathaway of digital. And so under Alphabet, you know, obviously you have Google, but then we have Google Capital and Ventures, which is funding some of the coolest startups in the world. You have Nest. Anyone here have a Nest?
The
thermostat, connected thermostat's pretty awesome, right? You have Google Fiber, 100x the internet speed. You have Google X, which is doing 10x ideas, and I'll talk about some of these crazy ideas they're doing. Verily, Calico. Calico's job is to combat aging. That is their mission. When you think about that, the average person, man in America, dies at 72, and a woman is 78, which is a shame. It shouldn't happen. We should all be living to 150. And we actually have people that are working on that now, so all of us in this room should be living to well beyond we're 100. And then we're going to have to do something with our skin, by the way, because we're going to look all not so attractive at 120. But we'll get there. So lots of cool stuff going on at Google. But then you actually think beyond Google. And you think about our world today. And by the way, normally I'm talking to old people who don't realize that the world has changed. I'm talking to people that you live and breathe digital. You all grew up with a cell phone from a pretty early age. When I was in college, in fact, I didn't have a cell phone in college. When I got out of college, I got my first phone, but I didn't get a cell phone. I was like, why would you have a cell phone when you could have a car phone installed in my car? It was pretty cool. And I clearly wasn't so cool. But if you think of every single minute of every day, lots of emails being sent. There's 400 hours of video uploaded to YouTube, and now we just came out with a new stat, over a billion hours of videos watched on YouTube every single day. So a billion hours, that's some serious hours. You have lots of apps being downloaded. So I'm in healthcare. You know how many health-related apps there are in the world today?
A lot.
Yeah, you would never get this, besides my genius friend here, she might get it. It's 160,000. Of those 160,000 apps, the top 50 of those apps make up half the downloads. So it's pretty compelling there to say lots of stuff going on, almost all of it isn't very good. If it's good, people will use it and download it. If it's not, the wisdom of the crowds will decide and they'll tell you if it's good or not. And so lots of apps being downloaded, lots of pictures being posted to Instagram. Amazon makes a lot of money every single minute of every single day. And even Android devices. You know that there's more Android devices, actually four times more Android devices activated than babies being born every minute of every single day. And that number is radically accelerating. So when we talk about disruption, think about all these companies that are now radically disrupting the world. So you take a company that has now the largest hotel company in the world. It's in 34,000 cities, a million listings every day. It has a market cap larger than Hilton and Hyatt combined. Anyone know who it is?
Is it Airbnb?
Airbnb, my friend. And it's a large, perfect size. There you go.
Thanks.
Airbnb. And to think like Airbnb, for their size, and they don't own a hotel room. You think about the largest retailer in the world and how it's disrupting Walmart, who used to disrupt all the mom and pops, and now you're seeing what's happening at Walmart and Target, all these other with Alibaba. You see, we all have seen, all of us here take Uber. Is Uber popular here in college campuses? So Uber, we all know the Uber story. And I travel every single week, and I'm at the airport, and I look at all the lines and lines of cab drivers, and I think, these poor guys, from now until they retire, they will make less money every single year. And the problem with that is we see how Uber just came out with a better model. It's just so convenient, it's cheaper, and it works better. But what does the cab industry do? Instead of embracing disruption,
they try to make Uber change.
Yeah, sure. They're making Uber change. They're trying to fight disruption. And the thing is, I saw that years ago. Now, we're at Google, so we're at the forefront of disruption. I thought, these idiots, they're going to lose. It's impossible. Like, there's a tidal wave coming, and it's impossible to push that back. But cab drivers were saying, we're going to keep Uber out of our city. You see, almost every city I go to now, Uber is allowed. And so when we think about that, and when I talk in the healthcare industry, I'm asking all these guys, I say, very simple question, are you disrupting or are you being disrupted? When you think of it like that, and especially, so I work with big pharma companies, and I say, these are multi-billion dollar companies who have not recognized that the world is changing, and some of the decisions they were literally making in 1978, they're making today. So I raise the question, I say, if you made a decision, and by the way, I think this is something you should all think about, whether you're a CEO or whether you're a student, if you're making the same decision today that you made 6 weeks ago or a year ago, in their case, 6 years ago or maybe 30 years ago, is that the right decision? Could you possibly go back to that car problem? Is there another way to look at this problem? You know, at Google, we value diversity of our hiring in a very big way. You know why? Well, for a bunch of reasons. Number one, it's the right thing to do, right? But number two, we actually look through the data and see if you have people from different walks of life, and not just different skin colors and man and woman, but different walks of life, they bring different perspective, and you look at the problems in a whole different way. And I actually take great pride in that. You know, I have people on my team. I have a guy on my team today who grew up in the projects of East St. Louis. Has anyone ever studied about East St. Louis? One of the toughest projects in the world. Actually, not in the world, in the country. And he has a bullet hole in his leg. He never went to college. But he turned his life around. He became an entrepreneur. I met this guy and I said, Tim, I want you on my team because you have the hunger and the drive and a different perspective. And he's an absolute star 2 years later. And by the way, Google recruiting and HR, that stupid camera. They weren't that happy that they said, Ryan, you know, we don't do this. We hire people from Harvard and Stanford. Like, that's who we want to hire. When people from Harvard and Stanford, that's great. They could be smart. You know what else they are? In general, they come from wealthy families. And they never really worked that hard. And they come with it. So they have some talents. but in other ways, there's things that they're also missing as well. So, and I bring that up because going back to disruption, when you think of these companies that have disrupted, and by the way, it's normally a person, some 25-year-old, that is radically disrupting an entire industry, and on the way, also making billions of dollars. But think about disruption, and I equate it to a train coming in the night. We all see the train coming, right? You see the light, the horns blaring, the lights are flashing, and what do people do? Like, you should, like in the business world, they can do a few things. They could do nothing, which is what the Kodaks of the world did, or Blockbuster. They could say, okay, maybe I should change, but they're moving too slowly. And I guess Blockbuster would be a perfect example of that. Most of them, though, they see that we have to change. Big pharma companies see that they have to change, but they think too small. They think incrementally. So at Google, we have a big saying. We say, don't think 10%, always think 10x. So, and by the way, it's amazing. Once we started, we implement that for big and small decisions to say, are you just thinking small or do you think big? And I want to show an example of this. So imagine today if I said I would give you $1 million if you could make a gas-powered car drive 50 miles per gallon. Like you could figure that out, right? We have a lot of smart people in this room. I think they now have cars that go 40 miles per gallon. So we could just think incrementally, make the car a little bit lighter, a little bit more efficient, and we could get there. But what if I said to you, we need a car to drive 500 miles per gallon. Like, what do you do? Like, where do you even begin? You literally have to start over. You have to look at the problem in a whole new way. So you take something like internet connections. You know how many people today have internet? So there's 7 billion people in the world. What would you say? Most?
I said all of them.
So in fact, no, you know what it is? All this technology, at Google we talk about tech and tech gadgets and all this amazing thing that's going on, and they say, wow, look at how tech is changing the world. I say, tech is changing the world for rich people. But, so the answer is, 3 billion people are connected, 4 billion people, over half the world still has no internet, has no access to cell phones, has no access to all the things that we take for granted. So, if we think incrementally, how do we wire up Africa and India and the rest of the world that just today just doesn't have access to, they're just not wired to be able to get access to this. So if we did it the current way, and if we thought 10%, we'd have to wire up and dig all however they will do all their wiring, and it's gonna take 50 years. We don't have 50 years, because we see that today, you know, there's 121 million children today that have no access to education. 121 million, and that skews heavily for little girls. And that, I'm sorry, is unacceptable. So you think, if we could simply wire up the world, and how could we do that? Well, we can't wire the world. That's thinking too small, and it'll take too long. Why don't we put hot air balloons up at 75,000 feet in the air and have them ping off of each other like cell towers? Have you guys read about this? This is called Project Loon. Mm-hmm. So we have a massive, one just crashed in Amazon the other day. Imagine that huge balloon crashing in your front yard. But the crazy thing is this actually works. So imagine if you could give internet access to the world. And maybe it's Google who will do that. Maybe it's someone else. Remember, innovation spurs more innovation. So you have these hot air balloons up at 75,000 feet in the air, pinging around. You combine that with project, which I am most proud of, everything we do at Google, called, this is Android One. So my phone here, you know why the world is going Android? Is it that Android's so much better? I would actually argue that Android is very comparable.
Is it because it's cheaper, but it's just as good as iPhone?
Sure. You know, a lot of it is, well, so this phone actually costs like $650. So this isn't cheaper, and so the rest of the world,
I was just going to say, is it because it can scale to literally any form of hardware you can put on it, whether it's even like ARM or x86, it's just whatever you can fit it on, it'll generally run.
Sure, and so because it's open, phones. I mean, you have Samsung, LG, you have a million providers who are who are creating the phones. You also, so there's a ton of factors. One of them, of course, being cost. But the problem is that today you could get plenty of phones for $100. Those are not good phones. And so, but how can you make a good phone? A phone like this, then imagine if you could get internet connectivity, you can get a phone that costs very little. You can think back to those 121 million children. You know, you could get a college level education on your phone without ever leaving YouTube. And you start thinking of the millions of moms today that have never been to a doctor, that are pregnant, they have no idea how to raise their kid. You can go online and find out everything you needed to know online. To me, that is a 10x idea, and that's a game-changing idea that will change the world. So you have other ideas like the driverless car. So we've all read about the driverless car. You know, Google, we came out with the driverless car first. That was probably 8 years ago. You know what the industry said? Everyone laughed at Google, said, Google, you guys are crazy. Do what you do well. Stick with search. Search, by the way, makes us $90 billion a year. But you know the problem with that? Search is starting to flatline. So we have grown every year after year, for the last 18 years, at least 20% a year. And to be a $90 billion business and still growing at over 20% has never been, you know, you guys study, that's why you study about Google. So you take the driverless car. We started that, which now you see every car manufacturer is building their driverless cars. All of you in this room will have a driverless car. So when you think about disruption, though, what industries are about to get radically disrupted? So there's the obvious ones, right? Like the auto industry.
Taxi companies,
sure. Auto insurance. Trucking.
GPS,
sure. You see, like, I'm amazed that Garmin is actually still around, but it's still hanging on.
So is the driverless car still able to be manually driven?
So I've actually driven in this car. This car, by the way, if you're a single guy, you'll never, ever, ever get a girlfriend in this car. Just saying. But this car has no steering wheel, no gas pedal or brakes. And it's been tested for millions of miles, and this car actually works. So to think, but now the industry has to catch up, you know, like each state makes their own laws, you have insurance companies, and God forbid there was ever an accident, like, so there's things we have to figure out, but think about how we can take disruption further. So if you have driverless cars, and all of us will have a driverless car, but think about that, do you actually need to own a car if you have a driverless car, or you just have Uber say, come pick me up, right? So if we don't need to own a car, do we need to park a car? If we don't need to park a car, do we need parking lots? If we don't need parking lots, could those parking lots now be parks? Think about traffic. Traffic goes away. Traffic is caused almost always by human error. People are driving at different speeds, they're getting in accidents. All of that goes away. 1.25 million people die every year in car accidents, almost all human error. All of that goes away. And you see the disabled, the elderly, people who have drank too much, and we joke about that, but that's true. Imagine like all this good stuff that comes from it. Someone brought up the point about truck drivers. That's actually a very legit concern that we have, because all this great technology is disrupting the world, but it's also about to put millions of people out of a job. And we have a moral obligation to think through all that and say, what's going to happen to all these people? What is robotics going to do to the assembly lines across the world? And the good news is, with all this new technology, it almost always brings better jobs. It creates a new ecosystem. So we're hoping that in the driverless cars, which we all soon will be having, think about that. Like my kids, I'm wondering, will they even get a driver's license? Will they ever know how to drive because they can just get one of that? You know, to think, so that we're literally, it's right around the corner that this will happen. They even have this dude. So, by the way, this is actually, you know, at Google we have a big robotics division too. So imagine you're sitting there going on a stroll through the woods with your buddy, and you see that thing. But the thing, and by the way, this video is 2 years old. You see somewhat the robotics, I mean, I think that, like a robot can do that now in 10x of what you're seeing. Not just physically, but also the machine learning, which I'll talk about in a second. So that's some pretty cool stuff that they're doing. We've virtual reality, which any gamers, how many of you are gamers? So you'll see how VR will, you see how that it will literally is going to change the world, certainly change your industry. I actually think about these meetings. I fly all over the world doing doing talks, and I think, you know, it's just a matter of time before we just, this is all VR. And the fact, like at Google, you know, I have no phone at Google anymore. Everything we do is video conference, and we're already testing out VR and seeing, like, that's the future. And it's amazing to me that, like, everyone hasn't caught on to that. To see, it just makes everything much more efficient. You have the contact lens. Has anyone seen this? So this comes from our Verily group. This is literally a contact lens. That microchip there is a microchip. That is like a miniature computer in your eyeball that monitors glucose levels every single minute of every single day. How cool is that? If you are a diabetic, to know that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you have all, not only you, but say you're a child, your parents, your caregiver, your doctors. Yeah, that's a question.
How does that communicate if your levels are low?
It goes to the cloud. That's all connected, you know, that's literally just Bluetooth and
okay.
Right to your phone. And so, you know what, I forget sometimes the group, like some of these groups I'm in, they would never even think to ask that question. I forget who I'm talking to. So you're probably wondering then, like, wait, so there has to be a battery there, right? So there actually is. But remember, technology has gotten so cheap that this contact lens you throw out every single day. So they've been able to, imagine that. And so to think that that little microchip costs less than a test strip, where people have to finger prick their hand, and now it's just all, so imagine where you could take this. Where it gets even cooler is to think that we have a team of Google that their job is to miniaturize that microchip. So think about that. That microchip in your eyeball, imagine what you can do when that gets even smaller. So what I want to, you know, I'm in healthcare, so this is what we think about. So imagine, you know, so I'm driving here today, and I got a light that went on my car that said my back right tire was low air. And I thought, and I was like, okay, that's cool. But you know what really bothers me? That I could have stage 4 cancer right now, and I don't know it. And that shouldn't happen. So when you think about if you can monitor glucose levels, why could you not swallow a pill? And then it'll tell you, hey, you're at risk for a heart attack. You have stage 1 cancer. If we could find stage 1 cancer versus stage 4, your chances of survival go up over 90%. So you start thinking where technology can do some pretty cool stuff. Like, this is pretty amazing, right? And this is one of, like a lot of different projects that they have going on. You have things like machine learning. Machine learning, everything that we're talking about, machine learning is going to change the game in a radical way. This happens to be a case we've been doing in the UK, where you can have machine learning studying optical images to combat eye disease. And they can do this a lot faster, a lot cheaper, and with massive, massive scale than any like a room full of 1,000 doctors. So imagine where you could take that. That machine learning, is anyone here have a Google Home yet or an Echo? You know, so this, the machine learning is very much in play with what they're what we're doing on here. This is all the voice recognition.
So machine learning,
I want to show you this video. This kind of explains it all.
Rather than writing 500,000 lines of code, we instead have the machine learn from observations about the world.
And we looked through a bunch of these examples in the machine learning algorithms, maybe millions, maybe billions, maybe even trillions, to identify the patterns and generalize from there.
In the task of image recognition, we've been able to train models to take the pixels of an image, and from those pixels, learn high-level features.
It starts to learn that if you see a cake and you see a kid, it's maybe a birthday party. If you see a cake and lots of kids, it's very likely a birthday party. That's essentially teaching the machines to do the perception that we humans are so natural and so good at.
You realize just how amazing humans are, just how amazing your 4-year-old is who can recognize faces.
Machine learning has really been the beginning of a big revolution in the field of speech recognition.
To teach speech recognition and to interact with a noisy room, we use real-world sounds and we mix it into the examples that we already have.
Is it cold outside? Is it cold outside? Is it cold outside?
Now, no matter what the noise in the environment, our speech recognition systems can understand what you're saying. They can separate out one speaker from another.
with machine learning, we have now an algorithm that learns how to simulate a human linguist.
A lot of the language that we see today is very formal.
Blah, 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 blah. And they say, okay.
Interspersed with emojis and stickers. Now, with Google, we're getting to the point where you can have a much more natural conversation. Any good Mexican places around here? Here you go.
The assistant product that we're building at Google uses the best of our machine learning techniques in speech recognition, image understanding, natural language understanding.
That's a promising direction for developing systems that can really navigate the mess of the real world. We wanted to make this an open source project so that everyone outside of Google could use the same system we're using inside Google.
There are lots of people who have made very, very creative uses of it without knowing a single bit of machine learning. So if they have the ideas, they don't need to do the heavy lifting that we've already done.
I saw a cool example where somebody used to have a cat going around their house all the time, so they trained a model to identify whenever the cat was there, and they would turn the sprinklers on to scare the cat away.
This elderly couple in Japan who ran a cucumber farm, and one of the big tasks is to sort cucumbers into, like, prickly ones, less prickly ones, straight ones, curved ones, and it's actually a complicated task. So the wife would spend many hours a day sorting cucumbers. So the son picked up a computer vision model and was able to build a system to categorize the cucumbers and sort them automatically. All the time wasted sorting cucumbers is just going to be used in much better ways.
387 million people with diabetes are at risk for diabetic retinopathy. It causes blindness. The way that you can find signs of diabetic retinopathy is by taking pictures of the back of the eye. But there's just simply not enough doctors, and it takes hours for an interpretation. So we trained an algorithm that can read the images right then and there. The algorithm can help the doctors get more people screened for the disease.
The more you see machine learning and the kinds of things it can do, the more you see opportunity for it to improve people's lives.
You can use machine learning to save power at significant scales, even track the spread of diseases and epidemics.
We could use a computer vision model for everyone who's visually impaired.
We could make speech recognizer for everyone on the planet and drastically improve the experience of millions and billions of people.
I don't see any area of science or even of human endeavor that learned systems can't help with.
If you'd asked me a few years ago if a computer would be able to do this anytime soon, I would have said, I don't really think so.
It's very, very empowering to imagine what's going to come.
We're thinking thoughts and doing things that, you know, no man has ever done, and sort of setting forth and setting foot in really new intellectual territory here.
The promise of AI and machine learning is that we can actually produce solutions to previously unsolved problems that will really help people.
Pretty cool stuff, huh? It's, you know, it's amazing when I see something like that. Like, I get asked all the time, so Ryan, what's happening in 5 years? I'm like, I don't know. Like, every one of my predictions will be wrong because we see what's going on. Like, with machine learning, how it's just going to change the game in so many ways. It's pretty remarkable. And you think, so I showed that video to a bunch of CEOs, and I said, why is it that some grandma in Japan can figure out how to sort her pickles in using machine learning? And we're not taking your company with all of your billions of dollars of resources and haven't figured this out. So I end with this quote, and this is something that on our team, it's something that we live by, and it's a daily reminder to say that our greatest danger is not that we aim too high and miss, but that we aim too low and hit. And I would say, like, if I had to be, like, I'm going to go off script here, but I was thinking, if I could go back to college and think, like, I had no help. Honestly, like, I went to college. I had to put myself through college. I didn't come out of college with anyone saying, hey, Ryan, I have, like, friends or parents who could help me get jobs. So I just kind of winged it. And I thought, you know, if I could have gone back, I wish someone, like, gave me some better direction on some things. Like, when I'm getting out of college, like, what can help me succeed? And remember, it's not that you're the most technically sound, because whatever you're learning today will be obsolete in 5 years. So what are those things that you can instill, like, what, like, will make you great to stand out? And I actually narrowed it down to, so by the way, the list could be like 50 things. To me, people actually can't remember 50. try to keep it to three, but in this case, we're gonna talk about five. Number one is about running fast. And this seems obvious, but remember, so Google for 8 years in a row now, or 10 years, for a long time, has been rated the best company in the world to work for. Everybody wants to work at Google. Anyone here not want to work at Google? All right. Sometime, my friend back there. But I remind people, I say, so every time we have a job opening, we literally have thousands. We get literally like 3 million resumes a year. So I'm looking through a resume, and I see all these Harvard MBAs, and I say, okay, so Becker, Harvard MBA, like, why should I hire this person? And so you have to remind yourself to say, I am going against the best people in the world, whether it be Google or any job you're going for. Like, everybody who is going to succeed runs fast, and it's a daily reminder to my team. For everyone who's on our team, I say, listen, do you want to be promoted? You want more money? You want more stock? We get stock every year, all this good stuff. We give it purely based off of how good you are. And so, and everyone here is running fast, you must run faster. And so it's just a good thing to constantly remind yourself. You look at, like, I just had lunch the other day with this guy who plays for the Buffalo Bills. And I think to be a professional athlete means every single day, your entire life, you wake up, you have to be incredibly disciplined and work and train more than the next guy so you can succeed and be at that level. It also holds true for everything we're doing. So even down to, I'll skip through, down to, what is a GPA? Does a GPA really matter? And I'm sure some of you are like, eh. But remember, when I'm coming out of school, so Google, we used to have, when I started at Google, no matter what, so you're tiered based off of what college you went to, and then if you didn't have a 3.5 GPA, you would not be, they refused to even interview you. You immediately got thrown out of the pot. We've since gotten rid of that. You know why? Because of the diversity. We're trying to look and say, okay, just because you have a 3.5 doesn't necessarily mean you would be great. It could mean that you are not well-rounded and all you did was focus on your school. I actually still use that requirement for people who have less than 10 years experience, because to me, I say, if you don't have a good GPA, it means one of two things. It means you didn't try, or it means you're not smart. Both of those are bad. And so, like for our team, I just look, I'm the only director at Google, I interview every single person who comes to our team. And they have gone through, it's a pretty rigorous system to get through, but all I'm looking for are three things. Are you smart? Are you ridiculously hungry? Like, will you wake up and do your best every day? Like, you know, I love the saying, today I did my best, tomorrow I'll do better. And the last thing is, are you a good person? Do you want to change the world? And those are the three things I believe you can't teach. You're either smart or you're not. You're either hungry or you're not. And you're either a good quality person, because remember, at Google, everything we do is about teams. So do you want, no matter how good you are, if you have someone who's arrogant, do you want that arrogant person on your team? No. So number two, when you talk about hard work, so yes, I assume everyone here works very hard. What I quickly realize is that hard work without having connections will only get you so far. So if you haven't already, I highly recommend you start networking. You network through having a LinkedIn page. If you don't have one, I would recommend before you go to bed tonight, you set up a LinkedIn page. And you start networking with people like me and all your friends, your parents' friends. And because at the end of the day, like, I get notes all the time. The vast majority of people who get hired at Google and just in other companies is because I know someone and I say, hey, listen, I'm going to vouch for this person. This person's good. I'd like you to give them a look. That person was 1,000. There was 1,000th resume. They go to the first resume. Now, of course, they have to interview. But all of that helps. And so try to think, how can you network better outside of just LinkedIn? When you're at an event, it's very uncomfortable, like if you're in a bar or something, to go up and talk to people. I can't stress enough how important it is to actually get out of your comfort zone. If you're at an event with some sort of business event, like, get out of your comfort zone and go up and try to introduce yourself and talk to someone. You know how I got a job at Google? I met a guy in an elevator. So, and I think back to that day 12 years ago, when I'm in an elevator, I think, wait, what are the odds that I just happen to get in this elevator, happen to be in a good mood in New York City, and so I'm like that crazy guy who's talking to a guy in the elevator, and he keeps talking to me, and I'm thinking, why does this guy keep talking to me? And sure enough, we get off the elevator, he's like, hey, Ryan, so I'm a big shot at Google, you ever think of working there? I'm like, actually, I have. So that's how I got a job at Google. So think about all those moments that you potentially could meet someone in an elevator, and are you prepared? Like, life is just one big job interview. So, which brings you back to point three. You know, every single person who comes to Google, I have someone on my team who gives me a full portfolio, someone we're about to hire. Here's a full social media profile. This is everything they've ever said online. And we find it all. Because I'm trying to see very quickly, okay, we all make mistakes when we're 18 years old, but I also am trying to see, in our business, I need someone who has very good judgment. And if you're posting stupid pictures online, I'm like, poor judgment, I'm sorry. Like, they can't work on our team. And so think through that, and I'm sure you've already talked about that. And I say that, but I still, to this day, look at people who are 35 years old, and I go to their social media profile, I'm like, nope. And I scratch them so we all hear about that, you've read about it, I'm sure professors talk about it all the time. I would still highly recommend, if anything seems even remotely questionable, don't have it on there. Because everybody is looking, and if they're not looking, you probably don't want to work at their company. So 2 weeks ago, we're about to put in a job offer to this guy. Everyone loved him. He's the most personable guy, super smart, had a million degrees. And he sent me a thank you note with three run-on sentences. And I'm looking through this, and I'm like, what the? This dude went to Harvard. He actually did go to Harvard. Three run-on sentences and a typo, and then like a comma was, like, yeah, the like comma was wrong. Oh, and he also got it's wrong. And I'm like, it's IT apostrophe S. Your. That's another one. So you guys know better. But, and I look at that, you know, that guy, if he never sent me an email, he would have been offered a job. Instead, I forwarded that note over. I said, no, he is not. If a guy can't write a note, like that guy, especially in our new world, like the written word is critically important no matter what your job is. And you're being judged on that. So if you don't, and I was even thinking with that guy, at the very least, this thank you email is the most important note he's ever written. And you would think he would have enough sense and good judgment to go to one of his friends, hey, I'm about to send this note, does this look good? And to not even do that, told me, like his recruiting came back, hey, Ryan, maybe this, and I was like, no way. No, this is like, on our team, you know, we have three, I bucket everyone on our team in three buckets. Are you amazing? Do you have potential to be amazing? Or are you other? And if you're not in the potential to be amazing, like you can't work on our team. And I know that sounds super harsh, right? But, and people are like, if you come to Google, you know at Google we get free meals, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We have like convenience stores there. I get a massage every single week. All this stuff is free. Pools, gyms. And people are like, wait, that's amazing. It's like an adult playground. I say, yeah, it is. But we also are required to be amazing. And if you aren't amazing, every single quarter, everyone at Google has a GPA. You know, we have to rank every single person, myself included, and you're given a score. And in that score, like, it'll judge, like, how good you are and, like, your future career. So I remind people, I say, yes, it is amazing. If you want to play ping pong all day, you can do that, but you probably won't be here in 2 months. So it's, but we do all that stuff, by the way, the massages, because we've recognized that. Like, I go to the gym 3 days a week during lunch. HR requires me to walk through my whole team to go to lunch. You know why? They're trying to make sure the team, the example is set. Hey, the boss is going to lunch, or is going to the gym. We want you to go to the gym because we know that hour at the gym will make you more productive. And so, did I get them all? So, yeah, if you could narrow this down. So, everyone, get a LinkedIn page today. If your GPA isn't great, stop going out so much and get your grades higher. Because, by the way, at the end of the day, why would I hire you? So if you want a job at Google, and you have a Stanford guy and a Becker guy or just any college, and I look through, I'm quickly looking through, all I have to judge someone on is that piece of paper. So what is going to make me say, I want to hire this guy? Is it a guy that went to Exeter and then Stanford and then Harvard MBA and his family is like super wealthy and he's never actually worked a day in his life? And every job and internship he's ever had is because his dad or mom got him a fancy job? Or do I want someone that got really good grades, put himself through college, was working three jobs, and like, you know, really understands what it means to be hungry? So those are the type of people that I personally want to hire. And by the way, our team at Google has been ranked the best team at Google, the best industry at Google, for now 3 years in a row. And it's purely because they look for those people. You got to be smart, you got to be ridiculously hungry, and you got to wake up every day and say, I'm going to run faster, because if I don't run faster, the guy next to me is, and that guy is going to succeed. And the beauty of all this is, if you do all this, remember, like, I get paid a lot of money. I make my clients lots of money, but most importantly, I'm in healthcare. We are literally changing the world. And I think when I go out to meetings, I say, if you do not disrupt, if you do not do this quicker, people are dying, people are not living healthier and better lives because we are moving too slowly. So I think, and that's why I love my job. Like, I can do really, really well, but I also can do really, really good things at the same time. That's pretty cool, right? Which is, so hopefully one day we're all coworkers and we can all do well and good together. Thank you all. So any questions for... Yeah, do we have... That was a pretty muted class.
Does anyone have any questions, though, before we let Ryan go? Thank you for that. That was fantastic.
No worries. We talked about this disruption and the social impact of it. Who's really much concerned about that? And I feel that for the last 10, 20 years, disruption pretty heavy. And I expect it to be probably 10 times as great over the next 10, 20 years. So what is that? Can you elaborate a little on what Google is doing in that respect, as far as the social impact is concerned?
I hesitate because some of the things we're doing on are not public. I'll give you an example. You think of Google, so just think of what Google has done. And like Google, when we got big about 12 or so years ago, we have over 3 million businesses, 3 million that rely on Google. And that have started all these mom and pops that otherwise couldn't exist. All these, you know, the amount of stories that we have from all over the world, like that Japanese farmer who can now have a living that they otherwise didn't. So you look at the ecosystem that Google literally generates billions, hundreds of billions of dollars every year for the economy, for all these people who now have jobs out of their homes that they otherwise didn't. So I think the plan is that when this new tech comes around, it's going to create new ecosystems. And it's not just Google, but a lot of us are, if you read in the press, you should see like Google from Eric Schmidt, our executive chairman on down, are absolutely looking at this saying, okay, if robotics is the way to go for assembly lines, literally, I don't know how many, we're talking millions and millions of people will be out of a job. What new ecosystem will be developed now that those jobs are going to robots? And so our hope, you know, so, and I think Google has proven many times over that yes, we do, Google makes a lot of money, but we also do a lot, like, you know, give a lot back. We have Google.org that's literally giving billions of dollars away. So I think there's absolutely people looking at that. Really loud in here with this air conditioner.
Yeah.
Do you have a gentleman in the back first? My AOL friend.
What's Google's mission statement? How does that affect your day to day?
Our mission statement is to organize the world's information, make it universally accessible and useful. Are you impressed I know that? But you think, well, actually, when we started our mission, Google was literally a search company. But you think of everything we're touching on, And see that that actually still applies, that we're organizing this information, we're organizing big data to make this data more useful, impactful for the world, whether it's coming from Verily and contact lenses to search to driverless cars. So it all still applies.
So when we reach the point where we're throwing away, like, say, the contacts, what are the environmental impacts, and, like, where does Google stand on the environment if we're throwing away microchips every day in the trim?
We are recycling for. You know, yeah, we're clearly... Google, by the way, is, I think, believes the first company that has gone carbon neutral. So know that, I mean, we have data centers all over the world, and so we're very well aware of, and we have 72,000 employees. You know how many bottles of water 72,000 employees drink every day? So, you know, understand that we have people, I mean, we have teams of people that's their job to actually look into this to make sure what we're doing is good for society, but also obviously good for our planet as well. Yeah?
So I heard somewhere that certain branches of Google are looking for people that are well-versed in the 3D digital arts. Is this true?
You should, yeah, sure. You know, remember, we have 72,000 employees that are going across doing like all sorts of things, including like in our 3D virtual reality group is doing some amazing things. What I would recommend, anyone who's, you go to google.com/jobs, and it will show you every single job that's available in every single office across the world. And you'd be amazed. So I'll tell you though, like on my team, we actually don't hire people right out of college. And typically that's just, you know, we want people to have a couple of years experience, get their feet. Like, and for me, actually, I like even a few extra years because I want people that have been taught the ways of just like how to be a professional, how to make sure they come in early, write good emails, all those things that I think once you get in the real world, that you learn. But yeah, check out the job site. You'll see we have one office in Cambridge and then in New York, Atlanta, Chicago, LA, San Francisco, and a bunch of others in the U.S., and then all around the globe as well. Anyone else?
So you say that having new perspectives and being able to look at a problem from different angles is very important because that helps you disrupt different industries. For you personally, when you've kind of created like these new innovative ideas or helped with teams to, you know, help change the world, what do you think is the most important thing to help you kind of maintain that mindset and help you look at problems differently?
You know, that's a good question because, so right now I was just saying, guys, let's change the world. But the problem is, I went into a big pharma company and I said, hey, so you guys, clear, everyone wants to cure cancer, solve world peace, and so they're all thinking up here. But I said, by the way, did you know yesterday alone there were 1 million searches for rheumatoid arthritis and 60-something percent of them were happening on this phone? And I can tell you, if your phone takes longer than 3 seconds to load, 42% of people will leave. So you had 1 million people, so 420,000 people who just left the doctor's office were going to look for information and they couldn't find you because your mobile site stinks. And I'm sorry, it's 2017, you're not gonna cure cancer and cure world peace because you can't even do the basics right. So I would say the first thing is, like, to solve world peace, you literally have to be nice. We'll have to be nice to each other. And we take steps one at a time. I think it's just a good reminder that almost all the time when we're going to do those 10x ideas, you know, most of those ideas means you have to hit a home run. And the only way to hit a home run is to get up there and really swing. But what happens to every home run hitter, anyone who's a baseball player? They strike out a lot. And so you actually have to have a culture set up that actually rewards. At Google, you are rewarded for striking out. But in most companies, they actually don't have that. They say, if you strike out once, they're like, okay, you're kind of on a plan. If you strike out twice, you're fired. What will that make? Like, what do people do from then on? They're never gonna swing. They don't swing hard. All they're trying to do is get the ball in play. And that will always have a culture of mediocrity, and mediocre companies will always and everywhere eventually die. So, Like, so how do you just hardwire yourself to say, I'm going to, and by the way, remember, when you get a job, you're going to be, you're desperate to get a job, and so sometimes we take a job that maybe isn't the perfect job for you. And so if you should be thinking, like, I ask my team every day, scale 1 to 10, how happy are you? And if you're not above an 8, I say, why not? Is there something we could fix? Maybe you're playing the wrong position, or maybe it's just us, and like you're not a fit here. So if you're working for a company that has a culture that isn't a good culture, like, you don't want to be there. You want to work for someone, especially if you have talent and if you have drive, to work for a company that is going to let you rise to greatness. And it's sad, actually. If you look at the stats and see how many people actually love their job, the percentage isn't that high. And it's a real shame. Like, you know, at Google, the number is actually, like, ridiculously high. Like, I love my job. And I'm asked to leave all the time to take ridiculously well-paying jobs. And I always am like, oh, I love it. Like, we're literally changing the world, and, like, I'm good. So you have to think, how can you do that? And by the way, I can do that because Google loves me, because I do very well for Google. And the last thought, by the way, is I actually think through, like, how did I rise through the ranks at Google? I've been here 10 years. On paper, I'm a nobody. But everyone, I just kept moving up the ladder. And I think through, and it all goes back to when I was 22 years old. And I think my first job out of college was a guy, my boss said, hey, I want to meet every single day. And I said, sure, I'll meet whenever you want. He said, I'm a morning person. Can we meet in the morning? I said, sure. He says, how's 6:30? And I said, and I'm like, you know, but I played a poker face. I'm like, yeah, no, that sounds good. For the next 2 years, every single day, 6:30 in the morning, Monday through Friday, we met. So every single day I got in the office at 6, and I never left until 10 or later, knowing that I was competing with the best of the best. So at the very least, I'm not that smart, but I was going to work extra hard. And I look back on Charlie King, the guy who's like loco, and I honestly owe my entire career to that guy. He taught me so many good habits of just like really, really working hard. And I bring that up, by the way, because and I hate when people talk about the millennial generation, they're not hard workers. I don't believe that at all. I think 50% have, should work harder. But I find that I find plenty of good people that come in who can, like, I can't stress enough, like, when you get out there in the real world, it's not like when people are talking about work-life balance, or the first question is how many vacation days do you get? I'm thinking, like, so think through that. Remember, going back to the working hard, running fast, remember that. When you're getting out in the real world, like, how, like, at the very least, run fast means, like, first in, last to leave. That is actually frowned upon. A lot of HR, like, professionals would say, oh, Ryan, it doesn't work that way. I'm sorry, it does. Like, that is how I rose my career, and it's how, you'll see any CEO, you ask them, how they got there, or she got there, and that's always the case. Are we out of time? So any last questions before we go?
I just had a question, not necessarily about the healthcare element, but going back to the combination of, like, machine learning and, like, virtual reality type applications, especially now that they're getting cheaper with, like, the cardboard and daydream headsets, do you see that changing, like, things like education and stuff? Do you think, say, elementary, middle, and high schools might be kind of obsolete because you can get all of the information online?
That was an awesome question. I was going to bring that up. Our education system will be radically disrupted. The fact that you're all sitting here today, and the fact that you have to go to these schools, and whatever you pay here, it's a lot of money, and that money, it just keeps going up. When you think that online learning and everything you can do with VR and just going online and taking the exams and every, you know, you can get everything that you need. Do you need actual classroom space to do that? And so you start, so I 100% believe that we're going to start seeing it hit, we're already seeing it, all these online classes that are popping up. Once you see some of the big, big schools going there in a big way, like Harvard, all of a sudden, could you go to Harvard and get your degree online and it only costs $10,000? You think, what would that do to our education system across the entire globe? It has to happen because people today, how do you spend $50,000? Remember, the fact that you guys are all here today means you are in the elite of the elite status. I go to India 3 times a year, and I can assure you that you're having a bad day, go over to some of these countries, and you realize that how good that we have it here. So know that so you're the elite of the elite. Think of all those others that can't, that education, higher education just isn't an option. So I believe that the education system is going to go through a massive transformation. I hope so, because I have lots of kids, and it's going to cost me a fortune. All right, everyone. Thank you.